And welcome everyone to another Fish Report Live. We are in the Fish Report, I guess you call it the Fish Report Command Center, the control room, whatever it is, but this is the place where I do the Fish Report website on a daily basis, and been doing it here for 16 years now, so I'm pretty comfortable in this spot. But for starters, no cameras tonight. We're audio only. This is the same audio channel we use to broadcast Rushi Raider basketball games on, so we wanted to make it easy tonight for our listeners to tune in wherever you may be listening at. And yes, we are live. I enjoy doing these live broadcasts. I think it makes it exciting that way. And although I typically like to do high school sports interviews, there's really nothing going on right now, and that's because everything is on hold or maybe even canceled, and that's because of this whole coronavirus situation. So since my life revolves around extracurricular activities and there's zero action at Rushi Local School right now, I began to wonder this week, is there anything going on right now down at 100 School Street here in town? And I figured the best guy to ask is our guest tonight, and that's Superintendent Mr. Steve Rose. He's the guy in charge, and I'm happy to be talking with him here tonight. Mr. Rose, welcome to Fish Report Live.
Well, thank you, Craig. It's great to be here tonight.
All right. Well, listen, you have got a crazy job right now. You know, not only are you responsible for hundreds of kids, they're usually in your building. Now they're not in your building, but I think you're still responsible for guiding them somewhat. When all this coronavirus stuff came out, I mean, it was announced that Ohio was closing their schools. Did you have days, weeks? How much notice did you get?
We had days. I remember that Monday morning talking about we had cases in Ohio and we were starting to get scared. And I remember Miss Bixler telling me, hey, you think we'll shut down schools? And I kind of laughed and said, no, I don't think that will come to that, but let's make a plan. Let's talk about next week's staff meeting. That was Monday. And then Tuesday, I just like, oh, this is getting serious. I better start planning here. So I spent most of the day in my office like, okay, if we have to go down this down the road, here's going to be our plan, and we're making up draft notes. And then I'm thinking, Wednesday, let's talk to my Board of Education. So we had an emergency board meeting Wednesday night and said, hey, what is our plan? And I want your input for this. You're my community liaisons. And so we met in the library at 9 o'clock at night that night and said, hey, here's our plans. Here's what we do to continue education. And we had a staff meeting after school just saying, I don't think this is going to happen, but let's be prepared. Let's start talking about it. So when you go home tonight, have a plan B. What are we going to do to continue education if we're forced to do this at home? And has some big eyes saying, oh my gosh, is this really going to happen? And then the next day, we sent the letter home saying, if we have to do this, this is our plan. And later that day, bam, it's done. So we had another emergency staff meeting said, okay, we have 2 days to prepare. What are we going to do? So we went from Monday thinking this could never happen to Thursday night, this is going to happen next week, Monday. What's our plan? And our teachers and students have been amazing. That is just awesome.
So when you mentioned the staff meetings, does that include teachers as well? Were they in the loop on this whole thing?
That includes all my staff, and I invite all the aides, janitors. We all got to be on this on the same page. Let's brainstorm together and figure out what we're going to do about this. You know, what age can do all digital? What age is that not an option? And some grades have hybrid lessons. And so that was all part of the brainstorming activity that Wednesday and Thursday.
Well, you know, Mr. Rose, when I'm out and about and I'm driving around, not just Rushi, but other neighboring towns, I'll be out in the middle of the day sometimes for my day job, and I'll see kids out in the middle of the day. You know, I know some kids that are working some jobs right now, some even close to full-time jobs. Are our students getting the education that they should be right now?
Well, I want to say our teachers are doing an amazing job. They are still getting an education. They're still getting a quality education. But is it the same education they would receive in Rushi School? I wish I could say they were, but that's not happening. You know, we can't reproduce all the amazing things our teachers do in the classroom to a at-home environment. We're sending video lessons home, and that's great, but it's not the same. So we're doing our very best, but I'm not going to say they're getting the same education. It's hard.
So things like I've heard that state testing has been canceled or grade cards. What's being done there?
Well, for the most part, state testing is not going to happen at all. There is no report card this year. So that's one stress that the students and teachers are not feeling. And I always say, that's not something to stress about. Let's just be confident. We do great. Let's show that's our state tournament for academics. The kids don't see it that way, but that's why I always try to tell my third graders, like, this is our chance to show off how smart you guys are. So I'm probably the only one disappointed we don't have testing this year, because I think it's a great way to show what the great things we're doing here. But it's a stress we don't have, and so I'm glad they did it, because it allows us to concentrate on the reading, writing, math, and arithmetic. the basics and not worry about doing it on the test and how we're going to make that up.
Yeah, I know you've always got a proud tradition at Rushi of great state testing, and it's something definitely to be proud of. And yeah, so I bet you do miss not being able to do that this year.
I'm one of the few that gets competitive with academics. Everybody else is sports, but I want to be the best in the state. And I always tell my kids, like, this is our chance to show off how what we know. You shouldn't be stressed. Be confident. We do great every year. Just show them what you know, and you'll be fine. And I'm not sure they buy in that all the time or not.
You know, I was talking to a Rushi husband that has a teacher over at Versailles, and she was talking about how much tougher her job is right now because she's teaching from home. You know, sometimes you think, oh, you get to work from home. That's pretty easy. She was saying that it was tougher to teach at home. And then on top of that, she has kids that are demanding her attention as well during the day. You've been in communication with Rushi teachers. How are they handling all this?
So the first couple of days during the shutdown, so that first week, all teachers still were assigned to come to school. So we had a whole week of we're in our classroom for 8 hours a day. We're making up lessons, and those days were very, very valuable because Eric Sollenberg was kind of our guru to the flipped classroom model, and he was helping me download YouTube videos. And one of the things I said, we're not sending worksheets home to the elementary kids. You know, this is not just giving them work and say, parents, go teach it. We need to provide lessons. You know, we need to be providing lessons. And, you know, some great examples, my son, he's in first grade, and Mr. Adderman did a Zoom conference in first grade today. I mean, first graders loved it. And they get to see each other, make funnies, and raise their hand, tell them show and tell. And they did a scavenger hunt in the school. That's teaching. You know, that's not just, hey, do your math worksheet. So one of our goals was, hey, we have a whole week to prepare. You know, we're all in here all day long. What are we going to do to continue teaching, not just providing work for them to do? And they did an amazing job. So after that, then we went home, allowed teachers to stay home and work from home. And there's a lot of teachers that are in their building every day. You know, they got young kids themselves, and they said, thank you for letting me come here. I got a quiet space. I can do make my videos, and the internet's better, and all the resources I have at school are just, you know, much better for that. And we encourage staff to work odd hours. You know, we're trying to social distance just like everybody knows. So, you know, I've been up there on Sunday mornings, and I see teachers' cars in the parking lot, and I see Friday nights. And so the teachers are doing a great job of getting their job done on their own time.
Well, you mentioned those teachers sending some of those lessons home and having the parents help out. When a student's in the classroom, you know, the teacher's there to support them, encourage them, prod them along if needed. Unfortunately, and not just at Rushi, but any of the schools, there's some kids that do not have that support system at home, and just things like turning in homework is a struggle. Does that concern you at all?
That was definitely one of our concerns from the very beginning, because we know the majority of our kids here have great support at home, and, you know, have someone there with them during the day. They're self-disciplined, and they're going to do just fine. They're going to get the work done. We do know we have students who don't have that same support. So what are we doing to support them? What are we doing for our special needs students who just take a look, learn differently? So we're really trying to reach out to them as well. I know some of our aides, again, they're working from home, but they have a set time every night, every day at 9 o'clock in the morning. The student calls them, and they talk on the phone for an hour or two. And I was amazed how hard they're working. Those kids are seeking help. So right now, kids call the school all the time. I put them to the voicemail. Voicemails go straight to the teacher's email. So teachers are still getting their voicemail, calling those students back. I know many teachers are giving out their cell phone number, and they said, yep, this kid's texting me, needs help. So we're still reaching out to them. And if there's anybody not doing anything, we're reaching out to them as well. We have a few of them, but not many. Overall, our students are just doing an amazing job keeping up with the work.
You talked about your staff meetings before, and you mentioned everyone was involved in that, as well as custodians. For those custodians or some of your cook or people that are non-teachers, how has this affected them? You know, cooks can't be working when you don't have kids at school.
Well, we're still providing lunches. One of the things, by state, this is the right thing to do, but it's also Governor DeWine mandated it. But we are providing free reduced lunch to anyone who requests it. And that includes kids that were on free reduced lunch and also anyone in the community. You know, we have community members who may have lost their jobs. You call the school, we will deliver a lunch, a warm meal to you every day of the week, Monday through Friday. So right now our cafeteria staff, the first week was, hey, let's get the cafeteria deep cleaning. Let's do those things that we normally do in the summer. Let's get those things off our checklist now. And then it was, okay, we're providing this many lunches per day, and we have a split schedule. So we have four cooks, so two work every day. They get their job done. They deliver the meals to the doorstep every day. We leave them on the porch, so we're not having no interactions with the people, and just for safety. And then they go home. So they're still working. Our janitors, we got a long list of work for them. we're starting our summer maintenance, and we're doing things that we normally don't have time for. One of the projects I think we're just finishing up today was the locker room floors, the shower floors in the locker room, they were looking a little rough. So we sanded them down and we're putting a nice coat of epoxy on them and fixing them up. It needed done. And, you know, the bleachers, you know, after every basketball season, we try to get through them in the summer, but we don't always get to have the time to do a thorough job. So, we spent days scrubbing the bleachers, getting all that pop and all that like, grime off the bottom. It makes a difference. So we're still working. We're just, again, I tend to have them all separate. No, you go work in the gym, you go work in locker rooms, and that's our way of social distancing.
You're right. That deep cleaning is stuff that it's always one of those things you're going to get to or going to do. And there never seems to be that opportunity. So here's that opportunity. Speaking of the gym, I know there was a little bit of an incident up there not too long ago where we had a little bit of a sprinkler system that went off and there were some concerns around the community. I know, did the gym floor get ruined? How's the gym floor doing?
The gym floor is just fine. You know, I have to say there was one of the scariest nights of Arushi is like, I get the call saying the sprinkler head broke and water's pouring down. How to shut the valve off? And I remember Miss Wolkamp was just almost in tears on the phone. Like, it's in that closet. Turn the valve. And in that closet was about 10 valves. Like, it's the one on the right. Then, no, Rodney Count's son was up there too and they got it shut off. But even those lines are so big. So even after we had shut off, it still ran for a couple minutes. We're guessing hundreds of gallons was on that floor. When I got up there and I saw it, I'm like, oh my. So we had the shop back and we got it cleaned up pretty quickly, but we know some went under the floor and we were scared. Okay, we got mold. Next day is the floor going to swell and start, and just need replaced. I mean, that's $200,000 floor there. So, I give Scott Borchers a credit. He came up with the idea. We took jumpy fans that, you know, the bounce houses that little kids have. And so we put a trash bag on them and made a little vent and shoved that under the bleachers. If you crawl underneath there's like a 2-inch gap.
Okay.
So we put those trash bags in that crack and pumped that air on one side of the gym, and then went all the way across the other side of the gym. So by the end of that night, we had 8 jumpy fans in there, all blowing in there, pumping air underneath that floor. And we did that for about a week. And every day we move them to different spots and, you know, dried out each. There's like a foot rails underneath there. So we did every railing once or twice. And we are confident there is absolutely no damage in the gym. So,
well, good. It helps when you have people in the community that care enough and have jumpy fans, I guess.
Yes.
To bail, yeah.
And when the first one worked, it's like, I'll get some more. And they just started showing up. I have no idea how they did it, but they're sending text messages out and we have 8 jumpy fans in there underneath the bleachers.
Well, you know me, Mr. Rose. I'm a big sports nut. And as I said, starting this thing out, I'm used to doing sports interviews. I know you talked about academics being the state tournament for you. And I know you have a very good athletic director and Mrs. Amber Cardano that takes care of all this for you. But your thoughts on not having sports at all right now, how does that concern you?
I love sports. I love what it does for kids. It gives them a chance to find a different aspect, build leadership skills. And it's such a part of socialization in the high school culture we have in the state. And so, you know, I feel sorry for our seniors. You know, some of the seniors, this is their first time playing varsity ball, or, you know, this is what the year they were going to go to state and track. And, you know, they've been working for this for all their whole lives. And I sure hope they get a chance to do that. I'm really impressed that they have not canceled the spring season. You know, to be honest, I think we all need that little optimistic hope that, hey, this still could happen. And, you know, I'm more optimistic than ever that there is a chance. I'm not saying a big chance, but I do think there is a chance that we could have a spring sports season. You know, for my own daughter, this is her first year of track and she was just starting to like pole vault and I got her into it. It never had that chance. So I hope for all these kids, they get that chance this year, even if it's a shortened season.
Yeah. I wanted to mention that I actually got a chance to watch your daughter last year during the cross country season or in the fall participate on the junior high team. You know, I've got a son that's a big golfer. One of the few things you're allowed to do right now is go golfing and he's been out to some of the local courses. Has your daughter been able to get out at all and run? Did she love it that much that she'd get out there and run?
Well, for the first couple of weeks, she did. I think it has kind of died off a little bit in the last couple of weeks. And, just today I was kidding, like, there's still a chance you could have a track season. She's like, oh, I better get in shape here. So, I'm not sure she did a great job of staying in that running mode.
I was glad to see the Ohio High School come out with a couple bulletins this week talking about they've got a plan in place. If it happens, they've got a plan. I guess you have to, but I'm glad to hear that they're still thinking positively on that. And speaking of positive, you've got a positive project going on. I'll call it there at the school, just south of the school. You know, I like to run and I run through the park. One day I'm running through the park and all your playground equipment is gone. And I thought you had a pretty nice playground to begin with, but it looks like you've got a new one going in.
Well, we did have a really nice playground. And I remember when we talked about this a couple of years ago, it was starting to have some wear and tear.
Yeah.
People don't believe me. No, everyone wants to argue this point, but this is the 25th year this playground has been used. And anybody says, I was in high school when we, oh gosh, I've been 25 years ago. So it was starting to have some rust issues. We had the tunnels were starting to break. And to be honest, in a year or two, it would have been a safety issue for the students. So we actually started talking about this probably a year and a half ago of, hey, we may need a new playground one of these years. And so we started talking about it, and it has really progressed. And so we started last year. We went a combined bid with Marion Local and Fort Laramie, and between the three of us, we ordered $500,000 worth of playground equipment. And our plan was to rip it out on the week after school was out. But I told the board, I said, hey, if they close it to May, we can't pass up this opportunity to start this process, because we had a pretty tight time frame. So when they closed school to May, we started removing all the equipment and put up for sealed bids. So right now our playground equipment is heading to Kentucky.
Kentucky.
Yes.
Someone, another school down there? Or?
No, it's going down to an RV park. Actually, a local resident who owns a business here also owns a RV park in Kentucky. And so he was a brave man, pulled it out. We needed Dan Paulus' help to dig it out. And he's hauling all this equipment to Kentucky, at least most of it. A couple of local bids came through here.
The equipment that's going in, the new equipment, if we got any kids listening tonight, they might want to know, what are we going to have?
We're going to have about everything. You know, it was one of those things. We had a committee of parents and myself going through this there, and we're going through the book like, oh, this is really cool. Oh, you see this? And it's like, it's going to be very similar to the town park as far as, you know, it's going to have poured-in-place rubber. It's going to have a concrete border. The town has a little taller slides, but we have more stuff, you know, because when we're out there, we have 120 kids playing at one time. So we want enough stuff that most kids could be playing and busy on it. So it's going to be some really cool stuff. You know, it's got every kind of slide and every little kind of climber you can imagine. And it's just going to be a lot of fun for our kids. And to be honest, one of my things on Monday is being delivered. And I can't wait to start taking pictures of the equipment and saying, hey, look what you can look forward to when you come back.
Construction on that starts?
Well, to be honest, we probably are not going to install it until June, because we got a lot of steps. You know, we need Dan Paulus to come and put the pad in. You know, I think Keith Meyer was hauling stone out today. I got Choice One Engineering. They've been helping out. They put out the entire blueprint on AutoCAD. And so they're going to come out with their GPS surveyor stick and then come mark all the spots. So we got a lot of work to do between now and then. And one of the things we can do is we're going to start assembling the equipment. So we're going to start building the slides. The salesman has kind of prepped me. Like, there will be like boxes and boxes of bolts and nuts. So that's one of the things. When I get bored in the office next week, Mr. Bixler and I, we may go out there and we may put some slides together, and I'll send some pictures out to the kids. But we probably won't install it till the week of June 15th. To be honest, we need the community. We got about 15 community volunteers signed up to help do that. So we're probably just going to wait until then and then put it in on June.
All right. Well, listen, I've got plenty of more questions to ask you. We're going to take a short break, but when we come back, I want to find out your thoughts on a big senior question, and that is prom and graduation, whether you think that's going to happen or not. I'll give you a couple minutes to think about that. We're live with Rushi Superintendent Mr. Rhodes. You're listening to Fish Report. We'll be back here in just a few moments.
Hey, sports fans, this is Drew Cloud with Allstate Insurance. My team and I take a lot of pride in educating people on proper coverage and limits when it comes to your specific needs, and how not having enough can leave you and your family on the losing side. Give us a call today at 937-506-4040, and we'd be happy to see what we can do for you. It's more than coverage, it's cloud coverage, where you're in good hands.
Hey everyone, it's Craig here at Fish Report, and Cruiser's Bar and Grill in Rushi offers a great variety of fresh food from their menu, from their delicious lug nuts to their homemade pork tenderloins. Stop in before or after the game with family and friends. Large screen TVs give you a great reason to watch sports while enjoying your favorite beverage. Stop in and enjoy the fun and atmosphere of Cruiser's Bar and Grill in Rushi, and tell them Fish Report sent you.
Made in the Shade Tents and Tables in Rushi specializes in rentals of tents, tables, and chairs. These work great for graduations, birthdays, weddings, reunions, festivals, or sporting events. For pricing options or to make your reservations, contact owner Adam York at 937-726-4992. That's 937-726-4992, or email him at madeinshadetents@gmail.com. Made in the Shade Tents and Tables in Rushi.
The Jewelry Barn in Rushi, established in 2011, is proud to give you the best quality and prices. They have a qualified staff to provide you with great custom jewelry and jewelry repair. The Jewelry Barn also offers ear piercing, watch battery replacement, watch link adjustments, appraisals, free jewelry cleaning, and inspection for worn prongs and loose stones. They are certified by the Gemological Institute of America in diamond grading and color stone grading, and also certified in jewelry repair. Come in and check them out at the Jewelry Barn in Rushi.
Hanging at the Fish Report. 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 Hanging at the Fish Report.
Hey, welcome back to Fish Report Live. We're with Rushi Superintendent Mr. Steve Rose tonight and talking about all that's going on with Rushi local schools, even though there are no students or teachers in the building. Well, not only are you dealing with this from a superintendent standpoint, but also on a personal level, you're a husband and a father. How are you handling this at home right now?
Well, one of the things I think is safety comes first. So, you know, yes, I interact with people, but you know what? We're trying to maintain that distance. We're washing our hands, using hand sanitizer. You know, we're doing the packet exchange. Our original plan was to have everybody come in the door and find their packets and walk out. We started thinking that's probably not a good idea to have every parent K through four come in the building and pick up their packet. So we started the curbside delivery. It works really good. We take the packets and we put them in a milk crate, and then we put them in quarantine for 24 hours. You know, we somebody may have it, they don't know it. So we put it in the conference room. We'd say, teachers, you can't have access to it until it's been sitting there 24 hours. That's how long it lives on the virus can live on a paper product. So we store it for a couple of days and we send it to their classrooms, and then they grade it and then give it back.
Well, I knew about the curbside packet pickup, whatever you call that there, but that's because you do a wonderful job on social media. I follow you on Twitter, and I assume you're probably on Facebook as well, yep. But a wonderful job of keeping the community informed on social media.
I give Mr. Bixler a lot of credit for that. He has really helped our social media presence, and to be honest, he's taught me a lot. So I am now the official poster on Facebook. I know nothing about Facebook, but I can make a post and I can put the messages out there.
I'm pretty close with you on that one. Before the break, I asked you, or I said I was going to ask you about a couple big senior moments, and every senior, you know, remember, or most seniors at least want to remember their prom and their graduation. Mr. Rose, are either of those things going to happen?
They will happen. That I make a promise of. I just can't tell you how and when. You know, we've been brainstorming and people ask, what is the plan? And until we get more information, we cannot make a plan. No. Do I still have a dream that we can do graduation as scheduled in May? Absolutely. That is our dream. If we can't do that, I'm not sure what the best plan B is. Is it to do it in June and just have parents, not grandparents, our immediate family, and they'll cut the crowds down? Do we do it in July and have a traditional one by that time? Do we need to do it where we have do it virtually? I don't know, but we will give those kids that memory. And same with prom. You know, do I think we're going to have a traditional time? No, I don't think that's going to happen. And we've already been talking. Do I think we're going to be able to get the hall this summer? Because I know there's a lot of weddings being rescheduled. I'm guessing that hall is booked every Saturday from here until December. But you know what? Maybe we get creative. We do prom on a Friday night or a Sunday night. Or maybe we do it at the Catholic War Veterans Hall. I'm not sure how we're going to do it, but we will give you an opportunity to have that once-in-a-lifetime memory because that's important.
Well, let's talk about things from a financial standpoint. You know, that one big part of your job is taking care of the school from that financial standpoint. What kind of impact is all this going to have on the school, or does the government just take care of everything?
Oh, I wish the government was just going to take care of it and that money grew on trees, but that's not the real world. So right now, it's having a very little impact on us right now. You know, we are having a little bit of savings because we're not running buses and we're doing, not spending fuel and that kind of stuff or heating the building as much as we normally would. But that's a pretty insignificant part of our operation cost. And our budget's set for this year. So, you know, we're not seeing a decrease in funding now. But what I'm worried about with everybody being unemployed, the state revenue is going to go down. The governor's kind of give us a heads up. Hey, beware. There's going to be cuts in all the state budgets. We know that will come down in our next state budget. I don't know how severe that is going to be, but we are definitely a little concerned about what that will mean from us 1 to 2 years from now.
So it's nothing you can really prepare for now or even talk about because you don't know what the future holds.
No, there's really – our budget from the state is set right now, so really there's no impact now. No, all of our contracts are already set for this year, so there's no savings right now for salaries and those kind of things. So we're just going to kind of wait and see what it will be, but we're prepared to be a little tighter in the future.
Speaking of meetings, school board meetings, are those something that have been postponed indefinitely?
Well, it'll be interesting. So next Wednesday will be our first official virtual meeting. We're doing a Zoom meeting. We just sent it out to the paper today. So if any community member wants to join in our Zoom board meeting, we don't get too many members on a regular meeting, so I'm not thinking we're going to get very many, but people are a little bored right now, so we may have more people than ever. But if you send me an email, I will send you an invite to the Zoom conference, and you can join in. And if you ask it ahead of time, you can even ask us questions over the internet.
Is that something that the Zoom or the GoTo meetings? I know there's several different formats out there. Is that something you use prior to all this happening?
You know, we use it on occasion. I probably used it once or twice a year. You know, it's kind of nice for a lot of professional development in Columbus. If I can't make it, I can download it and watch it later or watch it virtually live. But I've been impressed with what you can do. You know, I've been in a superintendent's meeting once or twice a week on a Zoom conference, and it's been great that you can network with everybody in the state of Ohio and say, hey, no, we can meet with the counties, we can meet with the whole Northwest Central Ohio, and we're learning a lot of great ideas from each other. They actually, Hilliard Schools over there is having one for every subject area. So if you're a high school art teacher and you want to attend a Zoom conference, see what other art teachers are doing in Ohio, you can log in at 11 o'clock on Tuesdays. And it's really neat. There's probably a list of 50 of them they invite you to. I went to one with elementary principals last week. And it was just neat to hear what other people are doing, and kind of we all share ideas and learn from each other.
You know, we talked earlier about working at home, and has there been anything that you found that have been more positive for you, things that you've discovered, hey, we can do this, even, you know, with teachers at home, or stuff we thought we couldn't do before that we can do now?
Well, absolutely. I think this has forced us all to expand our comfort area. You know, one of the things I asked the teachers, not only to send lessons home, but also do a video. So I said, I don't know if you saw it, but I did a YouTube video I put out to the community, just kind of explain where we were. That's not my favorite thing to do, but it's like, hey, if I'm asking my staff to do it, I need to do this myself. You know, we were using Schoology. We brought that this year for our grade 7 through 12. It's a great program. Some teachers were using it all the time. Some teachers were using it sparingly. This has forced all the teachers to really become masters of it and do videos and that kind of stuff. So do I think some of the things we learned from this is going to make us better teachers next year? Absolutely. Some of my virtual meetings, instead of me driving an hour to Lima every other week? Absolutely. I'm fine with going to a virtual meeting for these get-togethers.
So May 4th, that's the magic date here right now when we're supposed to go back to school, correct?
That is correct.
What's your gut telling you? I mean, what do you think it's going to happen?
Do I think it's going to happen? No, I do not. My gut's telling me we're probably not going to have school this year. But you know what? I saw that little bit of optimism inside of me. You know, maybe there's a 10, maybe 15, 20% chance that we have it. That would be great. I know some of my elementary teachers are missing their kids so much. I mean, they got into teaching because they love kids. They want to have those few weeks with those kids to say goodbye, to build those bonds, and then set them up for success for the summer. I hope we have it. That'd be great for everybody. But, you know, our health comes first. So, you know, if they do cancel school the rest of the year, I won't be disappointed, but I also understand they're doing it for their own safety. So my gut says we're probably not going back this year, but you know what? I'm still going to try to hold out to the very end.
Well, you know, you're probably like myself. I find catching up with Governor Mike DeWine and Dr. Amy Acton on what they have to say on basically a daily basis. Mr. Rhodes, if they were sitting with us on this interview and you could ask them something, whether it's confidential or, hey, listen, I'm not getting this from your conferences, anything that you would ask them. I mean, what do you want to know that you're not hearing right now?
Well, I'd be curious, what is it going to be to make a decision on a school? You know, what has to happen? Hey, if this happens, you will get to go to school at this time. If this happens and if this grows this way, this is going to seal the coffin. There is no school this year. So I would love to know what data they need to know. And I hope they make a decision early. I know even the last extension, it was Tuesday, and then we're supposed to start school on Monday. Now we need at least a week's notice before we can prepare those packets and have everything ready to have a seamless line of education there.
Once all this finally does get back to normal, does life change any different from how we knew it? Do we go back to exactly how we were doing things before? Do we quit shaking hands? Do we just wash our hands more frequently? What, anything else? Do we change life the way we know it?
Well, I had a conversation with my board members today. You know, when we go back to school in May or even in the fall, the world's going to be a different place. You know, I don't think the virus is going to be gone. I don't know. It's going to be a year till they get a vaccine, they say. And, you know, so with most of the people in this community still not having immunity, you know, it could flare up again. So do I honestly think things are going back to normal? No, I do not. I think we're going to have more precaution. I think we're going to be wearing face masks more than we ever have. You know, you never saw that in Ohio before.
Yeah.
But you're going to be seeing that. We're actually just making plans. You know, there's these foggers you put in schools, and they put electric charge in the disinfectant, and it goes cleans all the surface to kill it. You know, we're looking at, we need one of these for next fall. You know, we've never had one of those before, but I think we're all going to have one by the next start of next school year.
Well, Mr. Rose, listen, I know coming into tonight, some of us and some of our listeners out there, maybe we're feeling a little disconnected from the school system. Many of the parents I know feel like we're up at the school on a regular basis, whether it's for academic reasons or athletic reasons. So not being able to do that for the past month and being able to talk with you tonight about Rushi Local School was a cool thing to do. And I hope you enjoyed this interview as much as I did.
Absolutely. It's my pleasure.
Well, any plans this weekend for Easter? What are you doing with the stay at home mandate going on?
You know, not much. Maybe me and the kids that do, we've been doing a lot of hiking lately. We did, Tawawa Park in Sydney, and we did Fort Laramie Park last week, and we might do some hiking tomorrow, and just the four of us for Easter dinner, and we'll make the best of it.
Well, thanks for being with us on this Easter weekend. We look forward to seeing you at the school hopefully sometime soon. Until then, since folks can't see you in person, if they did want to get a hold of you, what's the best way to do that?
Hey, call me anytime. I'm still in the office. You can email me. We're here to serve you. We are community servants, and if you need help with your kids with the homework, let us know. We'll do our very best.
All right. Well, that will wrap things up for us here tonight at Fish Report Live. Thanks for joining us, and look forward to another interview next Friday night when we'll be talking to local singer and songwriter and the voice behind the Fish Report theme song. That's Mark Cantwell. So until then, have a great rest of your evening and happy Easter, everyone.
Hanging at the Fish Report. Hanging at the Fish Report. Hanging at the Fish Report. Hanging at the Fish Report.